God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for these, your people,
yes, Lord Jesus,
who are in this place today. Lord, they don't want to hear my words. They want to hear a word from you. Because we all recognize the fact that you're what we need. We don't need a plan. We don't need some instructions from a faraway place. We need you.
Amen.
In our lives. And as we sit during this quiet time, God, I pray you will open up our minds. Let our hearts be receptive to the things that you would want us to know. And we set recognizing it's not a general situation, but it's a personal one. Is that your word is specifically for me when I hear it. And so, God, we're saying thank you. Speak, because we, your servants, we do listen. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. If you recall, on 2 weeks ago, hopefully you were here 2 weeks ago. If you were not, I'll kind of give you a slight, brief little synopsis of what we talked about 2 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago, the sermon title was When You Have That Sinking Feeling, when you feel like you're going under. And we could go under for various reasons and all. And in that message, we talked about some symptoms, which I'll give you in a few minutes as well. We talked about some symptoms of knowing that you're going under, and we talked about what God does. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. But today, we want to talk about what you do, okay? We talked about the symptoms. We talked about what God does. Now, what you do. Okay, let's look back in a small review. To be able to know, 5 symptoms of knowing that you're sinking are simply this: when I can't see my way. When something is going on in my life, I can't figure it out. I have no way, I don't know how, I can't find a method or whatever. I feel like I'm sinking. The other thing is that when I feel like I'm on my own, nobody cares, I don't feel like anybody loves me, nobody's helping me or whatever, I get that sinking feeling. When I feel like I'm out of my comfort zone, in other words, that was a norm that I had for my life, that was a norm that we had for church, and then all of a sudden now we are outside of our comfort zone. And so many times on Sunday when I show up, I'm just not sure of do we do this way or that way or whatever. Gives me that sinking feeling. That's a symptom as well. Another one is this: strong forces are against me. I'm dealing with some issue in my life that's a major crisis. It could be an addiction. And addictions are really major things to deal with in life. How to break a habit or something that we've been dealing with a long time in our life. It's a strong force that's against me as well. And number 5, on how I know that I'm sinking, or a symptom of such, is this: I'm struggling, but I'm failing. That means I'm trying this, I'm trying that, I'm trying every possible thing I can. Nothing seems to work out for me as well. Then I know that I'm sinking. So when I have that sinking feeling and I know about it, then what is God doing? This whole time that I'm dealing with this circumstance, what is God doing? First of all, we find out this when we look at the passage of scripture. We found out that Jesus has already prayed for me before it happened. He had already prayed. While his disciples were in a boat going somewhere, he was on a mountain praying for them as well. And we need to know. And the second thing is this. It is what Jesus is doing when I have that sinking feeling is he knows and notices your struggle. Not only does he notice it, he knows about it as well. He sees you in your struggle. The fact the scriptures say he saw them straining against the wind. He knew it. And I just want to say something to somebody today, that if you're in a place and you're struggling in your life, you need to know God already knows about it. Oh, yeah, we still pray about it, but God already know about it. And guess what? He knew about it before you came to that place in your life. You need to understand that as well. He notices your struggles when you're sinking in life. And what he does is he will come to you at the moment of desperation. In other words, when you are past self-reliance, when you're past this point of where I ain't got nobody but God, then you recognize that you do have God. You remember the disciples, they were in a boat, they were on a 2-hour journey. 9 hours later, he showed up at a moment of desperation. Just before dawn, I think the passage of scripture will say. So let me just say this. Maybe the problem that you're dealing with in your life, you haven't been in it long enough to be able to stop, listen, going to the neighbors and going to your friends and going everywhere and doing all your human research and things like that. God's just waiting on you to turn it over to him in his life. And the second, last thing that he does, what God is doing is he will show you his true identity. And what do I mean by that? When he came to his disciples on a boat, he said, "It is I." His true identity. And what was he doing? He was walking on water. So he was basically showing you is that I can do some things that are not even logical in life to be done. I can walk on water. I can get to you anywhere, any shape or form in your life. And you need to always remember that as well. So what should I do? What should I be doing while all this is going on, while I have this problem in my life? What should I do if I'm sinking? First thing is simply this. I need to have courage because Jesus Christ is with me. I need to recognize that he is there with me in the storm. That's the idea. Mark 6:50 says this. They were terrified when they saw him. When he was coming to them, they're already at this point of being terrified. They were terrified when they saw him, but Jesus spoke to them at once and said, "Do not be afraid. Take courage. I am here." Yes. So you need to understand that, you know, that's a starting point when you're dealing with in a storm or you got all kind of stuff going on in your life. The starting point is be courageous. We need to understand that. Not because of myself. Be courageous because Jesus Christ is with me. That's why I'm courageous. Now remember this. What really then is courage? Courage is not the absence of fear. Courage is when you move ahead despite the fears. You are scared, but you're still stepping in a positive direction in life. And if you're not afraid, you don't need courage in your life. Courage is when you do the right thing, even though you're scared to death to do it. You do the right thing despite fear in your life. And I want to say this to you. Do not let your fears dominate you. Don't let them control your life. Because God has not given us the spirit of fear. And we need to always understand this. So I'm saying have courage. Now just for a moment, let me say something to parents. We're at a day and time where we need dads that have courage. We're at a place in life where we need some moms who are courageous, who don't wimp out when they're dealing with circumstances and situations in their life and dealing with their children. You're in charge. You need to understand that. And your children or whatever will try and manipulate you to bend and compromise on the values that you have in your life. And I'm telling you today, as a parent, stand strong and be courageous. And you need to understand. Here's something else you need to understand and keep in mind is that your kids will never become courageous unless they see you courageous. You must understand that if you are a fearful parent, you will raise up fearful children. If you are a courageous mom or dad, you'll raise up some courageous kids in your life. Courageousness is not taught, it's caught. In other words, you model it in front of them. And let them know that. How do you model it in front of them? You let them know that there are some storms in this world. There are some things beyond your human control in that life. Make sure they know that. You don't have to hide everything that's going on. Listen, if it's a loss of a job or having difficulty in paying a bill and things, sit them down and let them see. When you set them down and let them see the amount of income that's coming in and the amount of expenses, the outgo that's going out, they can then better look at you. And when they're looking for the $150 sneakers, they know it ain't no money left to get no sneakers like that. And that's when they might settle for some, maybe like, you know, go to the flea market and find an imitation pair. Don't hide your storms from your children in life. You got to understand that. You must understand this. Everybody knows the viruses are contagious, right? But fear is contagious as well. But you must also understand that courageousness is contagious as well. I always want to see my family, my children, my grandchildren see me respond very courageous in a situation. I never walk into a situation when they're bringing me problems and act like, oh, Lord, I don't know what we're going to do now. We're going to go to Jesus Christ. That's what we're going to do. And we're going to go to God and we're going to figure this thing out. That is the idea. So listen, when you feel like you're sinking, your part in this is to be courageous in the middle of the circumstances, the situation that you deal with. The second thing is this, you need to take a risk in faith. In Matthew 14, verse 28 and 29, it says, "For then Peter called to him, to Jesus, and said, Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you walking on the water." When I read that verse yesterday, I don't know how many times I've read it in my life, I saw something in it that I'd never seen before. Peter said, "Tell me to walk on water just like you walking on water." He saw courageousness being modeled before his eyes. He said, "Tell me to walk on water as well." And what did Jesus Christ say to him in verse number 29? He said this, "Yes, come." That's it. And Jesus said, and listen, Jesus said, "Yes, come." So Peter, not even doubting, went over the side of the boat and walked on water toward Jesus. Now listen, that just absolutely blew my mind. That Peter, basically, we're going to do it in faith, but Peter wanted some ID. Make sure. In other words, Jesus, if it's you, tell me to come. In other words, Peter was not doubting the fact that a miracle could be done by God. He wasn't doubting the fact that he couldn't walk on water or anything like that. He just wanted to know, is Jesus who giving me the instructions to do it? Yes. Don't miss that point right there. When you are in a circumstance, a situation that you're trying to deal with in life, you just need to make sure it's God's word. It's God's will. It's God's way that you're doing it. That's what you need to understand. You got to understand that. If God is telling you to start a business or to do something in a certain way, you'll be able to look at him and say, "Lord, if it's you, I'll start the business. I just need to know it's you in my life." And I just want to tell you something, is that if it's not God, you're going to sink. Ain't no doubt about it in my mind. Sooner or later, you'll sink. You may be trying to get out of a circumstance, a situation in your life, and it may seem like I'm struggling, but I'm failing. That's exactly what will be happening. You'll be going over and over around about the same thing. I'm struggling and I'm failing. But I need to know this, is that if it's God's will, if God said it, if God told me to do it, then all of his promises are yea and amen, and you know that. And what Peter recognized that fact that he got out of the boat, said he went over the side of the boat, just like that. And he learned one of the most important lessons that I believe that's in this particular passage of scripture, is that it is safer to be with Jesus out of the boat than to not have Jesus in the boat. Now, any of us, wouldn't you think the safest place would be the boat? But the safest place was to be wherever Jesus was. That is the idea as well. And Peter recognized that fact. That's why he said, "I'm in the boat, boat's rocking, being tossed and thrown by the wave. But out there where Jesus is a safe place." That's what you need to recognize. Where you are in life, you're getting buffeted by the storm, by the circumstance or situation that you're dealing with, but out there where Jesus It's a safe place that you can hang out in your life. Yes. Listen, I bet you Jesus had to be so thrilled that day. That had to be the highlight of Peter's career that day when Peter said, "Can I come out there where you are? Can I come to you, Lord?" That had to just like be awesome to Jesus Christ. Can I come to you? Listen, I know it's scary, God, but I know you can handle it. That, you get that? You want to make Jesus happy? It's tell him, I come to you. If I'm broke, I'll come to you. Listen, if I'm still addicted, I'll come to you. If I cannot pay my bill, I'll come to you. That's the idea in my life. Listen, Jesus didn't say, no, Peter, don't come out of here. Jesus said, come. That is the idea as well. You know why? Because he saw Peter respond to his problem with faith. And I'm saying, take a risk in faith. That's the idea. Jesus saw the response in faith. And what I've come to know in life is that, as Hebrews 11:6 says, for without faith it is impossible to please God. Anyone who wants to come to him out there must believe that God exists. Listen, and that he is a rewarder of those who sincerely seek after him. In other words, this reward that God's going to give you, he's going to save you even in the storm, outside of the boat as well. A man by the name of John Osterberg, in his book, he writes this quote, and he says this simply, and somebody needs to hear this today. If you want to walk on water, you got to get out the boat. You cannot walk on water sitting in the boat. Amen. Now, question. Where in your life at this present time do you need to get out of the boat of? Where's the fear? What's scaring you as well? You know, is it that you've looked at things, maybe your finances and all, and say, I don't have enough to give. God is saying, get out of the boat. That means give in faith. Take a risk. It's what he's saying. I'm scared to death, God, but I'm going to do it anyway because I believe that's your word. How about sharing Jesus Christ? We talked about that so well this morning in Sunday school about being hospitable. Not because we really want it to be hospitable, because that's God's way. And so what that does is when we are being hospitable and giving and generous to other people, what we're doing is sharing God. And I'm scared to do it, God, but it's your way. It's what you want as well. How about this person who has done something to you in your life and you think that it's unforgivable? Let me just tell you something. It's not unforgivable. You have to understand that in your life. It's because God wants you to forgive them because he has forgiven you. Amen. As well. So take a risk in faith. You better understand that in life is that you're going to have to step away from the circumstances or situations that you're dealing with in your life. What is the third thing that I do? When I have that sinking feeling, the third thing that I do is I stay focused on Jesus. I look to Jesus. I look to the hills from whence comes my help, and all I know all my help comes from God. Matthew 14 and verse 30 says this, but when he saw the strong wind, this is Peter now, but when Peter saw the strong winds and the wave, he was terrified, and he began to sink and said, save me, Lord. He shouted. Now, the shortest prayer probably on the page of the scripture is that right there, save me, Lord, right there. And see, some of you are in problems, or you're in predicaments, or in situations or circumstances that you're dealing with in your life, and you're running all over the internet looking for answers and things like that. And you need to say, save me, Lord. That is the way. That is it. Listen. Because, listen, you stay focused on Jesus. But here is what it said. He was terrified, and he began to sink. Why? Because he took his eyes off Jesus. That is the idea. He looked around at things. Perhaps he looked at his circumstances, which was, it's rough out here or it's rough over there in the boat, whichever way. He looked around as well. So what I'm saying is that if I'm going to help this sinking feeling that I have in my life, I need to stay focused on Jesus. It was Corrie ten Boom who said this, that if you look at the world, you'll be distressed. But if you look within, you'll be depressed. But if you look at Christ, you'll be at rest. Peter looked around when he was going through a storm. He looked at what he was doing. He looked at the problem that he was dealing with in the life. And maybe, just maybe, somebody may have said to you in your situation that you're dealing with, how are you doing with the situation that you're dealing with in your life? And you say this, you say, well, I'm doing okay under the circumstances. And I say, what are you doing under the circumstances as well? See, God wants us to be overcomers as well. And you remember the illustration, circumstances are like the mattress. The mattress is fine as long as I'm on top of it. But if I get under the mattress, I will suffocate in my life. You get under the circumstances and you will suffer in your life. You must understand that. So Peter looked around, lost his focus off Jesus Christ. Somebody suggested that this probably was the situation as well. Somebody in the boat called out and said, Peter, what are you doing? Nobody can walk on water. What are you doing out there as well in his life? You can't do that. Don't you know nobody can walk on water? Nobody can get out of a situation like this. Didn't you know that you should stay in the boat? It's an impossible situation out there. It distracted Peter. What am I saying? I'm saying in your life, when you try to overcome some situations, you try to keep that marriage going, somebody's going to look at you and say, oh, it ain't worth it. Give up on it as well. How many people, I want you to think about this, how many people are furious with Hillary Clinton today because she forgave her husband for an act of infidelity? And people are mad with her as a result of it. That's just so crazy. Somebody will look at you and try to tell you this. You need to think it through. But when you think it through, you're thinking it through based on human wisdom, human reasoning, and things like that. You need God's wisdom, God's reasoning in a situation like this. It was said, a quote in a place, it said, for when I trust instead of think, I walk instead of sink as well in my life. You need to stop thinking about so very much. You need to stop researching here, researching there, or whatever. You need Jesus Christ in your life, and you need to understand that. When you want to change your life, change your focus. That is the idea. The thing that you're looking at, the thing that you're focused on, the top of your priority list, you want to change your life. If all that stuff stays the same, you'll stay the same as well. In other words, you need to stay focused on Jesus Christ in a situation. Maybe you've decided that if I just go to church, if I pray, if I do devotionals, if I do Bible study, if I do some things like this, then after a while we give up. We get tired and we quit. That's the same thing as losing our focus as well. Stop focusing on the problem. Stop focusing on how you're going to solve the problem and start spending your time with Jesus Christ. And listen to what it is that he is saying as well. So, when I'm sinking, what I can do is this. I can have courage because Jesus Christ is with me. I'll take a risk in faith because I know it's God that I'm going to. And I'm going to keep my focus on him. And then the fourth is this. I will not doubt. I'm not going to doubt that I can come out of this situation. Are you stuck in a place and you just feel like always been, always will be? Not so in life. Change your focus. You can move to a different place in life. Change the things that you are looking at in life. You can move to a different place in life. Stop doubting that you can overcome in life as well. Matthew 14:31, Jesus says this, and he reached out and he listen, as soon as he said, save me, Lord, Jesus reached out. Soon as he said it, I think the verse says immediately. He reached out, he grabbed him, and he says this, "You have so little faith. Why do you doubt me?" Now notice something. That really wasn't a big rebuke of Peter. We look at it sometimes, we go, "Oh my God, he just rebuked Peter." No. Because he didn't say you have no faith. He just said you have little faith as well. Little faith. And as we would look at the situation, those who had no faith, they were still in the boat. Don't miss that point right there. Peter had a little faith. You know, so often in our life, we think I need great faith to be able to do this. I need faith that's just gigantic. I need heroic faith. No, you need faith little, is what God would say. And when Jesus was teaching his disciples, he said faith the size of a mustard seed as well. Tiny, can't hardly even see that seed as well. Don't you sometimes think I need great faith to be able to deal with this? And many of you are saying to yourself, probably, you know, David, I really don't have faith. And I say, you got more faith than you actually realize it as well. Because many of you, you walked in this morning, you saw a chair, and you sat down in it. You know? It just took a little faith for you to sit down in it. Now, depending on your size, it might have taken more faith. But what I'm trying to say is simply this. We got it all wrong thinking big faith is what we need and great faith is what we need. You, listen, this has nothing to do with having faith. We're not even really talking about having faith or not having faith. We're talking about where you put your faith. That is the idea. You got in a car this morning. You came, you trusted the car because you believed that it would get you here safe. As well, the brakes would work and various things like that. You had a little bit of faith about that as well. You don't need, as we say this, great faith to make it through the pandemic situation. You just need faith in the right person. So then what is faith? Faith is something you do. It's an act. That is the idea. You got to get out of the boat in order to show your faith. Faith isn't, I believe, but I'm staying right here. No, faith is put it on the line. The other guys in the boat had no faith, and Peter was out of the boat, and we got to understand that as well. And so, what it is, when I'm sinking, I have to realize this, is that I need to be courageous enough to know that Jesus Christ is with me. I'll take a risk, and I'll do it in faith. I'll stay focused on Jesus Christ, and I'm not going to be at a place in my life that I would ever think that I cannot get out of this situation, because I know God wants me to be an overcomer in life, not under circumstances or problems, but to be able to overcome the problems and circumstances in my life. And the last one is simply this. I need to praise God. Matthew 14, verses 32 and 33. For it says this, "For when they had climbed into the boat," boy, you could just, if you read too fast in scripture, you will miss certain things. "When they had climbed into the boat," now who was that? That was Peter and Jesus. But look at the other line. It says this, "The wind died down." But verse 33 simply says this, "And those who were in the boat worshiped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God." Peter didn't say it. All the ones that didn't have faith that stayed in the boat, they see it. What am I saying? You can model certain things in society and people will be saved because of what you do. But if you have the only answer, which is Jesus Christ, and you can't see your way clear, you can't see how we get out of this pandemic situation. If you don't have any faith, how is the world going to have faith? Because Peter got out the boat, and because he and Jesus got back in the boat, they that were in the boat, they worshiped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. And you must understand that in your life. What I want you to understand Any way you can, you praise God while you are in the circumstance or situation. You praise him even in the storm. Listen, even if you feel like you're sinking, praise God. Even if you're scared to death, praise God. You have to understand that. Praise him and thank him while you are in the storm. And either you have options when you're dealing with storms in your life. You can either worry or you can worship. You do one or the other. You can either panic or you can pray. You can either tremble or you can trust. You can either have fear or you can even have faith. It's your choice in a situation like that. But how many of you today will believe that if Jesus is in the boat, it ain't gonna sink? If Jesus is in my circumstances, he is in the midst of what is happening in my life, I'm not gonna sink. And even if I die, I am that Jesus Christ has given us. I am the resurrection and the life as well, because Jesus Christ has conquered death, and I need to know that. Question, right here again. Now, why did Jesus send his disciples into the storm? He sent them out there. Remember, he told them to get in the boat, go to the other side, and head up to Bethesda. Okay, why did he do that? 9 hours later, they're in the middle of a lake fighting for their life in a storm. Why did he do that? Well, he wanted to see, and if you remember the scripture said, he wanted to see if they had learned the lesson of feeding the 5,000. So what was the lesson that they mixed then that Jesus wanted them to learn, that he wants us to learn as well, is that Jesus Christ can do anything. And that Jesus Christ is all you need. And faith is the answer to fear that you're dealing with in your life. Question. What is the storm that's scaring you right now? What are you dealing with? Loss of a loved one. Finances. What storm is sinking you right now? Why do you think God is just allowing you to continue in this storm in your life? I'd like to submit to you that perhaps you're still relying on you. Lord, if it's you, bid me to come to you. That is the idea. Jesus has allowed you to stay in a storm for you to be able to say, Jesus Christ is all I need. Jesus Christ can handle the problem and the situation that I'm dealing with in my life. I know that he will come to me in the ninth hour. My moment of desperation, Jesus Christ will show up. And when he comes to me, he will come walking on the very thing that's scaring me. The disciples were afraid of the wind and the waves. Jesus Christ was walking on the winds and the waves. That problem that you have, he can walk on it. The thing that you are under is under his feet as well. He can walk on it. And when Christ comes, he's going to come walking on the way. And he'll say to you, it is I. I'm not asking you to come to me, because I'll come to you in your terrible time or situation. You need to stop being afraid and trust Jesus Christ in faith. Last question. How many storms is it going to take in your life before you trust God? How many storms? How many times are you going to have to repeat this situation? 30? 100? Maybe 2,000? How many storms is it going to take to break the self-reliance in your life? God is waiting on you today to say, bid me to come to you. Stand up with me, if you will. I don't know what problem, what situation that you're dealing with, but I want you to understand something very simple. You need Jesus in your storm.
I need you. somebody, tell them agree with me.